can change the world.
She's one of Fast Company's 150 Women Who Rock, Kathy Callen from the UN Foundation. Kathy, welcome.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
It's been 3 years. I'm excited to see you again because there's been an awful lot of progress in the last 3 years, huh?
Listen, the world is making great progress in reducing poverty, eliminating deaths for children and mothers, creating a healthier world for all of us to live in. They're called the Millennium Development Goals. They were created in the year 2000. The goal was to reach them by the end of 2015. That's under 1,000 days from now. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we've cut poverty in half in many, many, many countries. We've reduced maternal mortality by more than 50%. Children's mortality by more than 50%. So we've seen great progress, but we're not done yet. Mm-hmm. So we're all working very hard to make sure that all those countries in the developing world have the tools, have the resources, and have the political will they need to get there. Every citizen deserves a chance for a healthy and happier life.
So which is the hardest part, the tools, the resources, or the political will?
Probably the political will. But resources are really critical. And, you know, I'd say the developed world has done a good job of making pledges and bringing it to the table. But then it's met with incredibly good acceptance and prioritization at the country level. So, for instance, now when a woman dies in childbirth, we don't just dismiss it and say that happens. We ask why. Mm-hmm. And we investigate and we put things in place so it doesn't happen again. That's how we overcome these issues and make a difference. So we're seeing these countries saying, particularly about women who were second-class citizens, mm-hmm. they need to be cared for, prioritized, and put in the center of the development agenda.
One thing I've noticed, really interested from the UN Foundation or .org website, which is up on the screen, by the way, is you talk about sharing knowledge on mobile phones for maternal and child health. That's really interesting. The mobile phone is a huge tool, isn't it?
It's fantastic. You know, there's 7 billion phones in the world. There's maybe more phones than there are people with electricity in their homes. So what we've discovered is because people have the phones, sometimes they're able to use text messaging, and sometimes they're illiterate, but they can at least hear a message. Yeah. So for a pregnant mother who doesn't have the background knowledge or ability to get information about what to do during her pregnancy, she can be told when she should go have a checkup, what she should be eating, when she should eventually go and deliver her baby, and once she has her baby, when to bring the baby back in for a vaccination. So this is a powerful tool that allows us to get healthcare to the woman as opposed to having to get the woman to healthcare, particularly in rural areas where healthcare is far, far away. So how exciting to see a modern invention that's in her hands allow her to experience modern medicine. It's powerful.
And especially something that she uses on a regular basis.
Exactly.
Oh,
exactly.
That's so good. For people who are just getting introduced to the UN Foundation itself, what is the difference between it and the UN, and what do you do?
Well, the foundation was created by a billionaire philanthropist and entrepreneur, Ted Turner, 15 years ago. He felt it was very important to put his money where his mouth was. He was a great supporter of the UN as the vehicle and place where people could talk about how to get along in the world. And he appreciated the work they were doing to save lives around the world. So our foundation works in public-private partnership with the UN mm-hmm. and with other NGOs, other nonprofits, and the business community to make sure we're all working together to solve these big problems of malnutrition, gender inequity, maternal mortality, a safer and healthier planet. These are things that no longer can governments solve on their own. And frankly, the UN can't even solve them on its own. We need all parts of our society and all sectors to be engaged. So we try to be the convener for all of that to happen. So we specialize in vaccinations for children, women and girls, and clean energy and climate.
So basically everything.
Everything.
I noticed a partnership that you just recently announced surrounding global languages and the global language solutions. What will that do, and when are we going to hear more about it?
Well, it's fairly new, and for us, it's important to make sure that no one is left out. And so we need to make sure that modern technology, whether it be mobile phones, mm-hmm. modern opportunities for education, you know, the great new tool of the MOOC, the massively open online communities for mm-hmm. learning. These are all ways that we're going to talk differently in the future, and we just want to make sure that these tools are available to everyone.
Speaking of talking differently, you're being credited with coining a term called philanthroteams.
That's a great term, isn't it?
It is. I like that. Congratulations. What is that?
Well, you know, we discovered through several of our campaigns, one to send bed nets to Africa to control malaria, another one where girls in America are helping girls in the rest of the world stay mm-hmm. in school, delay marriage, delay childbirth. We discovered that young people are great activists. Now, we've always known they were great activists, but now we're also finding out they're great philanthropists as well. So they love to share what they have, they love to raise money, they love to advocate for a cause. So we did some research and found that 9 out of 10 young people between the ages of 9 and 19 are already philanthropists. So we're calling them philanthroteens.
Wow.
Because they've already got that instinct to give back. I think in my generation, we sort of thought that was something you do at the end of your life with whatever's left over. These young people are doing it today, and they're making a difference today. It's not about charity. They're trying to create change.
Is it of a global nature, or is it of a local nature, or is that a yes?
We studied the U.S., but we also know, because we look at and talk to our colleagues around the world, that this generation is a globally different generation, and there's more in common among the generation in all countries than there often is within a country between the generations. So we see this as a generation that's going to take hold, and they're not waiting to be invited to the party. They're making a change already.
Mm-hmm. Kathy, you've talked about the successes of the UN and the UN Foundation's efforts with regard to the Millennium Development Goals, but I suspect that there are some successes yet to be.
Yes.
Which ones are they?
Well, I'd say the biggest one we have to worry about is our planet. The wonderful thing about the Millennium Development Goals is that they attacked poverty. What they didn't reflect on was the changes in climate, the depletion of our resources, the fact that energy underpins all poverty. Mm. So I think as we go forward, we're going to have to bring the issues of sustainability together with the issues of prosperity. And that's going to be a bit of a challenge. It's a different way for us to think, but it's the only way to think. We need to think about people and planet at the same time.
Have you found in your work at the UN Foundation that there is more of a political will now to address that issue?
There's definitely political will to address both sustainability and poverty. Mm-hmm. How we address it, how we do it in a way that each country feels is fair, I think is the big challenge. So we know we have in the year 2015 a very large coming together of nations around a climate treaty. Mm-hmm. It's less important, I think, to worry about how the treaty comes out than to see what countries are doing on their own right now. There's no reason to wait. We can start putting in clean energy policies. We can start reducing energy consumption. Mm-hmm. We can start building better energy efficient buildings. Those things can happen right now, and we're starting to see that happen because that's in every country's self-interest, as well as being healthier for the planet.
By the way, you are on the B team.
I am.
What's the B team?
Well, it's right on this topic. So the B team was created by Richard Branson, and it doesn't stand for B for Branson, by mm-hmm. the way. But the idea is that we need a plan B for business. That plan mm-hmm. A, which is profit, 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 only profit, hasn't really worked as well as it might have because it's left behind people and planet. So the B team believes we need a plan that takes into account not only profit, which we obviously need to have companies producing profit so that we can grow, but we also need to make sure we're treating our people well and that we aren't using up the resources of the planet without thinking about how to restore and rejuvenate the planet. So we are a group of individuals who are committed to our own businesses to try to do better. We aren't mm-hmm. saying we've got it nailed either, but that we want to find others to work with who are committed equally to this new vision for business.
Speaking of new vision, the UN Foundation is part of a commitment here at the Clinton Global Initiative, something that I was surprised to see, not from a negative standpoint, I was very happy to see it actually. So Kathy, if you would, let's talk about the My World Initiative commitment.
Sure. My World was started by the UN mm-hmm. in an attempt to make sure that we got the voices of as many people as possible into the process of thinking about the goals for the next 15 years. Mm-hmm. The first time the goals were written, they were written quietly in a back room, and luckily 192 countries signed on. But this time, we need to know what everybody thinks, and we need to hear in particular the voices of young people. What's the world they want? It's going to be their world in 2030, not mine. Mm-hmm. So we felt that the My World website was a very important tool. It's a survey where you can say what you think the priorities are. We've asked our Global Entrepreneurs Council to help us take that website, give it more legs, give it more tools and more cool and whizzy things, mm-hmm. and then help us reach out to young people in a number of countries around the world where we want to make sure we include them. India, Ghana, Norway, you name it. Where can we hear the voices of young people and then feed into the process? So our commitment is to help grow the My World website and to do the outreach necessary to get as many people as possible on board. We have a million people already who've done it, but we think we can triple that.
So how can people join? Can they?
They just need to go to myworld.org and they can fill out the survey and continue the conversation. And we'd love to hear their views.
We're going
to
get that website up.
Good.
Too. Kind of in the closing mode now, as we come to this today. When I look at all the conflict that there is around the world, I think of my 10-year-old daughter, because I want her to grow up in a world that is safe.
Yes.
And I know from our conversation in 2010 that that's exactly the way you feel. Are we getting safer? Is our 2030 going to look a lot better?
Well, I think it could. I'd say we've got a long way to go on the safer question. You know, this is still a world where conflict is the rule of the game in too many places. It's a world in which violence against women and girls is still way too prevalent. And it's a world in which violence in general is the answer to too many problems. So we need to address all the issues from hunger to education to a proper treatment of women if we're going to reduce conflict and violence. And I know a lot of people want to do that. I'm counting on the younger generation to say that's the world they want. But we do have a ways to go, and we all need to put our shoulders to the wheel to make it happen.
Kathy Calvin, thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you. My pleasure.